Well, good morning, everyone. I'm Rob Atkinson. I'm president of ITIF. I want to welcome you to this event on attempting to explain the anemic U.S. job recovery. We saw the numbers on Friday, and only in the U.S. now could we say it was great news when unemployment dropped a couple of points, because a lot of people just quit looking for work. This is considered a sign of success now. We're not at 9. We're down, 8.6, I guess it is. Just because lots of people got really discouraged. But in terms of the actual numbers, we're still way, way down below where we'll be, and that's what we want to talk about today. So we have a great panel here who will also make remarks, so I'm going to start off with some remarks, and then we'll hear from Greg and Lenny. I'm going to introduce both of them. We should have plenty of time for questions or comments. We will adjourn precisely at 11:30. Greg Tassi, to my immediate left, is the senior economist at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, NIST. His major research fields are economics of innovation, technology-based economic growth policies, and R&D program impact analysis. He has a PhD in economics from George Washington, and he's published over 35 articles in policy and economic journals and written 4 books, the most recent being The Technology Imperative. And Greg is really, I think, the senior leader, if you will, in this whole field of innovation economics and understanding innovation from an economics perspective. So really pleased that he can join us. Lenny Mendonca is the chair emeritus of the McKinsey Global Institute. He's a director of their San Francisco office, where he leads the firm's knowledge development. He's also on McKinsey's board of directors and oversees the Global Institute and the firm's communications, including McKinsey Quarterly. He has a long and extensive background in looking at these issues. He's looked and written about and spoken about issues around globalization, economic development, regulation, energy policy, education, corporate strategy, financial services, and a wide variety of other areas. He received his MBA in the graduate school at Stanford, and also holds an AB in economics from Harvard. So we're not going to hold that last part against Delaney. He got inoculated by getting an MBA. Once you get an MBA, I think you're in solid ground intellectually. All right, so let me start with a question. How do we explain these kinds of symptoms? I don't think we have a laser, but that long red line on the bottom is the
government issue of mainly not working.
It doesn't work.
Tried a minute ago, and was.
There we go. You can't really see. Sorry. Okay. I think lights are fine. Okay. So the bottom red line is the current recovery, and the this line is 2000. Line of 90s. You can see each recession we get, we're much farther out in terms of not being a V, but essentially a long L. Now, eventually, at some point in time, we will recover the jobs that we gained. But according to Laura Tyson's work, it'll be 2023 before we regain all of those jobs and accounting for new entrants to the labor market. So that's essentially a 15-year period. Think about that, 15-year period, possibly, for this. Same kind of thing here. You can see this top graph, which is median change in family income, population to employment ratio. Again, you can see this big, big fall off. Employment to population has gone up, 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 and then the recession down has not recovered at all. So how do we explain all that? Explaining it and figuring it out, if this were a science problem, getting the right hypothesis and then testing it and then responding to it would be one of the most important things we can do. Unfortunately, economics is far from a science, and right now we have essentially, I would argue, 7 major diagnoses, sort of really 2 major ones and then some other ones, that are vying for the attention of policymakers. So whichever of these diagnoses you buy into, they then lead logically to a prescription. And that's what we're having a debate about. So the first diagnosis, if you will, would be essentially, look, every other recession we've had, we just do countercyclical fiscal and monetary policy that gets us back out of the trough. So this is just like that. It's just simply a super duper Keynesian contraction. Paul Krugman argues, quote, all the facts suggest that high unemployment is the result of inadequate demand, full stop. So if this is a demand side problem, you respond by doing things like more tax cuts, more public spending, things like the payroll tax holiday and things like that. But the fact that we had the largest stimulus in world history, and certainly in our history, and it sort of kept the recession from being catastrophic, but really hasn't made a dent in a serious way on labor market, it suggests that that's not enough, even if we had a $2 trillion stimulus package instead of 787. The reason is that stimulus is a little bit like bailing out a leaky boat. Or another way to frame it would be giving an adrenaline shot to a sort of comatose patient and waking the patient up, but as soon as the adrenaline wears off, the patient is back to being comatose. Real question is, why is the patient comatose? So this is the other theory that I think is sort of dominant, if you will. That's Ken Rogoff. He wrote a book with Carmen Reinoff called This Time is Different, 8 Centuries of Financial Folly. So his view is, you can look at all of these big financial crises that have occurred, and they're just really like a bad thing. They're like a serious flu rather than the Keynesian cold. And there's not a lot you can do. They're basically caused by an overhang of credit and liquidity. The recovery only takes a hold after these balance sheets have been straightened out, and that really only happens after a long period of time when there's no gain in asset prices, and finally people have straightened these out and asset prices start going back up again. Again, I think what's wrong with this is the question is, why did we have a financial crisis? Why were the countries with the strongest financial crises or the worst financial crisis also the countries that had the biggest competitiveness failures? Possibly there's a linkage between our competitiveness failure in this decade, which I'll get to, and the financial crisis. That's something Rogoff doesn't really admit. These financial crises are sort of like hurricanes. They're random. They just happen. This one happened, and now we're stuck with it. The third is one that I think the right seems to be pushing a lot these days is, we'd be doing fine if it wasn't for all this regulatory and tax uncertainty. So recent op-ed by conservative economists Gary Becker, Stephen Davis, and Kevin Murphy wrote, quote, even though some of the proposed anti-business policies of the Obama administration might never be implemented, they generate considerable uncertainty for businesses and households. Faced with high uncertainty, the prudent course is to set aside or delay costly commitments that are hard to reverse. First of all, it really has nothing to do with uncertainty. If we said tomorrow that we're going to have 100% certainty that corporate taxes are going to double and we're going to have onerous regulations on everything you do, that would be certainty, but it would deter investment. So it's not uncertainty, it's the direction of uncertainty. But the idea that uncertainty is really the problem now, when we have divided government, we have the House with Republicans in the majority, and we have the possibility of the Senate becoming Republican. The idea that there's really a risk that we're going to pass cap and trade in this country. Anybody who just pays their lobbyists some money and asks them, is cap and trade going to pass? The answer will be absolutely zero chance that cap and trade will pass in the near or medium term future. Likewise, are we going to raise corporate taxes? Likewise, are we going to end deferral? Likewise, all of these other things. These things just simply aren't going to happen. And the idea that that list is leading to uncertainty, I think is just simply wrong. A sort of related part of this is that some folks have argued, well, look at really the engine of growth is small businesses creating jobs, and they're worried about all of this uncertainty. Well, if you look at the NFIB report, Small Business Economic Trends, which comes out quarterly, monthly, anyway, the latest one, 10% of small businesses reported that the political climate is the most important reason for their outlook regarding expansion. So in other words, they're not expanding, they're not hiring because of the political climate. In contrast, 54% pointed economic conditions. So it's economic conditions, not political conditions. By the way, in 2008, when the Democrats controlled all three branches of government, the Senate, the House, the presidency, 6% reported that political climate was the issue. So now that the Republicans control a branch of government, that was pre-Obama. I take that back, 2008 is pre-Obama. But now that Obama's in office, we've gone from 6 to 10. That doesn't seem to me to be huge regulatory uncertainty. So, 4, there are lots of jobs out there. Companies want to hire workers. There just aren't workers with the skills. This is this notion of a skills mismatch. One of the leading proponents of that is the president of the Federal Reserve Board of Minneapolis, argues, quote, "The bigger issue of unemployment is mismatch. Firms have jobs, but they can't find appropriate workers. The workers want to work, but can't find appropriate jobs." So in other words, if we just had workers with the right skills of what companies want, all of those workers would now get jobs, the economy would take off, you'd have a positive stimulus because of that. Okay, sounds logical, but several, I think, core problems with that. One is there's been an increase in unemployment from 5% to 9% in 3 years. Wasn't there a skill mismatch back then, too? Did somehow in 3 years American workers lose their skills? Did somehow in 3 years the kind of jobs we're creating fundamentally shift? Second argument against that view is that there's a growth in the number of workers who are underemployed. It's been significant. So there are a lot of workers who are underemployed. They're working half-time, part-time. Clearly, they have the skills that are needed. They wouldn't be working if they weren't, but they're not able to work full-time because there aren't enough full-time jobs in the economy. And lastly, and most important, as a study by Miller and Wicks Lim point out, today's employers are filling their job openings with the same rate of success as they were in 2003. 2003 was a full employment year. Now they have the same likelihood of getting to hire an employee than they did 9 years ago, 8 years ago. So to me, the evidence that there's a skill mismatches, I think, is overblown. I should say, by the way, as a caveat, if this were a regression model and we were having the dependent variable, the R-square being unemployment, if I explain it, and you had 7 variables, none of those variables, the beta coefficients would be 0 on none of those. I'm not by any stretch of the imagination saying that regulation might not be somewhat of a problem or some skills mismatch might not be somewhat of a problem. My only point is to argue that they're the central problems, I think, is missing the point. The next one is this notion that the gas tank of innovation is empty. If we would just be creating more jobs if we had a stronger innovation system. And this is really popularized most recently by George Mason economist Tyler Cowen. And some of you may recall we did a debate with Tyler on his book, The Great Stagnation, How America Ate All the Low-Hanging Fruit of Modern History, Got Sick, and Will Eventually Feel Better. So Tyler basically says we just have lost the engine of innovations not happening. We can't innovate anymore. And the only thing we can do is sort of just sit it out. Eventually it'll kind of come back. And in the meantime, we just have to kind of get stuck with it. But again, when you look at the evidence of that, productivity growth rates from 1996 to 2010 were 3.2% a year, twice as fast as the productivity growth rate from 1974 to 1995. So the last 15 years have actually seen quite good productivity growth rate, not anemic productivity, which is one of the key factors from innovation. So the idea somehow that we can't innovate and that's why we're not getting jobs, I think, is misleading. So this one is all about there's too little innovation. This next one is the gas tank is full. It's too full. The robots are taking our jobs. So it's sort of the exact opposite hypothesis. This has really been popularized most recently. A lot of people have said this, but most recently by MIT professors Eric Bernholson and his colleague Andrew McAfee, who assert in their book, The Race Against the Machine, quote, "When discussing jobs and unemployment, there was a great deal of attention paid to issues like weak demand, outsourcing, and labor mobility, but relatively little attention given to technology's role. We want to correct for that." And then they go on to say, quote, workers are, quote, "losing the race against the machine, a fact reflected in today's employment statistics." So this is really easy to get behind because we experience it every day. We go to the airport, we're now checking in on a kiosk. We call something company up. We don't talk to a human being. We talk to a set of computers. So clearly, automation and robots are taking our jobs. If otherwise, we'd have more, right? The problem with this theory is that this has been trotted out virtually every single time we have a recession that's any more serious than the normal ones. In the 30s, there was actually a debate in Congress about whether the Secretary of Labor should create a list of machines and then estimate how many people would be employed if we could get rid of those machines. Great, so hearing, a wonderful, wonderful idea. Get rid of machines. 1961, John Kennedy created an Office of Automation and Manpower in the Department of Labor, where he identified in that the major domestic challenges of the 60s to maintain full employment at a time when automation, of course, is replacing men. Turns out the 1960s was one of the strongest decades for labor market growth, for labor growth and productivity growth. So another question is, if these job-killing machines are the problem, why, again, weren't they a problem in 2007 when we had 5% unemployment? Did we somehow have more job-killing machines after 2007? Well, in fact, we had less. So I talk about productivity growth being 3.5%. Actually, from 2007 to 2010, productivity growth fell by about half, down to not a little more than half, down to 2%. So after the recession started, we actually had lower productivity growth, which would suggest that the jobs weren't being killed by robots. If they were, we would have expected to see higher productivity growth. So the real issue there, and I just stress it, is all the evidence suggests that productivity is actually positively correlated with job growth, not negatively correlated. So let me get to what I think is the real problem. And I think it's a little bit counterintuitive, because when people hear this solution or this problem, they think long term. Hear that over, oh, well, we've got a short term problem. We can't deal with this competitiveness thing. That's a long term problem. Let me suggest that it is a short term problem. And let me just go through this and you'll see why I think that. First of all, one of the things I think we have to understand, which I think most economists in Washington are unwilling to do, is that there's a difference between traded sectors and non-traded sectors. If that barbershop were to go out of business, what would happen? It wouldn't be that somehow people wouldn't get their hair cut. They would just go get their hair cut at another barbershop, and we'd have the same number of barbers as we had before. It's just that barbershop wouldn't have business, but another barbershop would. Now instead, if we lost that company, which I don't know who it is, but some semiconductor company, and let's just say hypothetically they went out of business or they moved overseas, we would still have the same demand for semiconductors as we had before, but we would be meeting that demand offshore. So we wouldn't be redeploying that consumption domestically. So that to me is really, I think, one of the key things to understand this problem is that losing the traded sector has fundamentally different implications on labor market recovery than losing the domestic sector. This is why virtually every governor, and so when I worked for a governor and was doing economic policy, we didn't really have a barbershop policy. We didn't care about barbershops. We did have a policy around software, around biotech, around manufacturing, around financial services that were big and traded, because these were the engines of the economy, and if we lost those, the residents would be hurt. They weren't hurt if barbershops went out of business or grocery stores. So essentially, it's the traded sector stupid. When you lose your traded sector, that's a very stiff wind. Sort of when they say fiscal policy wants to lean against the wind in periods of expansion, this is a stiff wind against expansion, if you will. So how have we been doing on our traded sector? Well, let me suggest this is really the only slide you need to know. The blue is overall job growth. So in the 80s, jobs grew 19%. 90s, 20%, in the last decade, 4.5%. Do you think there might be a relationship between the orange bar and the blue bar? So the orange bar is the decline of manufacturing jobs. 7% in the 80s, 1% in the 90s, 32% in the 2000s. Most of manufacturing is traded, not all of it, but perhaps probably 95% of manufacturing is traded or tradable. And that's really where the U.S. economy took the biggest hit. So the question is manufacturing all about agriculture, in other words, high productivity and fewer jobs? Or is it really more about rust nation, just loss of U.S. capabilities and output? Let me suggest it's more about the latter. So that's the story you see. Okay, we've done these. Now, this precipitous drop after 2000 in manufacturing jobs. Well, isn't that all about productivity, as the Federal Reserve will try to explain to us? In fact, it's not. This is the productivity growth rate of manufacturing. This is jobs, by the way, and that's the productivity growth rate in the 90s was 56%, and in this decade it was 61%. That 5% delta is nowhere near explaining 32% loss versus 1% loss. So in other words, when people tell you that we lost 32% of our manufacturing jobs because of high productivity, just show them that graph. That was simply not the reason why there was an unprecedented loss. This is the share of manufacturing jobs we lost from the peak to the trough of the Great Depression. This is the share we lost in the 2000s. No other country has lost a larger share of their manufacturing base than the U.S. has lost. So this notion somehow that this is normal, or even as Larry Summers has once said, this is healthy, is just living in a different alternative universe. Now, compare us to other countries. This is a study by the BLS recently, and it compared job growth to OECD nations. We tweaked that data a bit to control for working age population growth, because, for example, Japanese don't have, they have working age population decline, so you have to control for that to get everybody equal. But what you see is the U.S., the lowest rate of manufacturing job growth, in this case a decline of 42% when you control for population growth, working age population. The Germans, 8% loss. So this isn't inevitable. By the way, German manufacturing costs are 30% higher than American, fully loaded labor costs. Sweden, again, pretty up there, Italy. Okay, so now another way to think about this, go and look at all of the, go to BEA, look at each annual year when GDP grows. So if it grows 1% 1 year, 2% the next year, 2% the next year, add up, just add those up. You get to 30% in the 80s, 32% in the 90s, and 28% in the 60s. So it's, you know, this decade's, you know, not bad. Now look at manufacturing's contribution to that.
Is that last chart U.S. or worldwide?
That's U.S. What happened here? You can see 80s in the U.S., manufacturing expansion added to GDP. In the 90s, it added. In the U.S., manufacturing contracted with GDP. This is what, sorry, that other chart was wrong, by the way. I apologize. That chart should have been much, much lower, so more like around 10%. I apologize for that. But that's what it would have looked like if manufacturing shares had not declined. So in other words, what I'm telling you a story about is the fact that U.S. manufacturing as a traded sector has lost significant competitive capability. And that's if we had had the same rate of GDP growth, we would have had 2.2 million more manufacturing jobs. So why is all that an issue? Why does that relate to the current recovery's anemic job performance? Let me suggest two quick reasons. One is, if you ever took macroeconomics or you're familiar with it, you remember the GDP equation. So change in GDP equals change in consumption, C plus I plus G, X minus M. Consumption plus government plus investment, exports minus imports. So any of those change of those factors affects GDP. One of the reasons we've lost GDP or haven't seen the biggest growth is that since the downturn, since the bottom of the Great Crash, we've seen a growth of our trade imbalance every year by a significant factor. So each year we have a bigger trade deficit than we did before. So as we stimulate the economy, a lot of that money ends up getting spent outside the U.S., and so you would have slower growth. But I actually don't think that's the major reason why our competitiveness failure is linked to jobs. It's part of the reason. I think the bigger reason was explained by Keynes 70 years ago in General Theory of Employment, when he said, quote, most probably of our decisions to do something positive, the full consequences of which will be drawn out over many days to come, can only be taken as a result of animal spirits. a spontaneous urge to action rather than inaction, and not as the outcome of a weighted average of quantitative benefits multiplied by quantitative probabilities. So this to me is like the most insightful thing I think Keynes ever said, which was, people make decisions about, should I put a new factory here? Should I go back to college and get skills? Should I buy a house? Not on some sort of, they don't get a giant spreadsheet and they figure this all out. I mean, that's part of it. But underlying that decision to take a huge risk, putting your capital down and hoping that something good in the future happens, it's fundamentally about faith. It's fundamentally about you think the future is going to be a lot better. And I would argue that what's happened is that Americans, including American businesses, have lost faith in the future of this country to be a world leader on innovation, productivity, and competitiveness. In 2012, only 60% of voters thought the next generation would be better off, and 60% of voters believe the next generation will be worse off. Only 10% said the next generation, my son, your children, will be better off. One reason for that is 62% said the U.S. is no longer the strongest economy in the world. But the good news, I guess, if there's a silver lining to this dark cloud, 60% of those who thought the U.S. wasn't the strongest economy, 85% of them said it was possible for the U.S. to regain the leadership of being the strongest economy. So I think Americans actually fundamentally understand what's going on much, much better than pundits. They understand the U.S. is no longer the strongest economy. We've lost significant ground. But they also have faith that we could regain that if we do the right thing. So I think in a lot of ways, getting a robust, bipartisan, aggressive national competitiveness and innovation strategy underway will certainly help the long run, but it'll also immediately help the short run because it'll regain and reinvigorate these Keynesian animal spirits, which we're so dependent upon to get out of this malaise. So I just close by saying I think it's one of the most important things we can do is to start making that connection between short-term stimulus, short-term job creation, and long-term competitiveness and innovation. And if we do that, I think the short-term will start to look a lot better than it has in the past. So thank you. Greg?
Okay, I'm going to say some of the same things that Rob has about the general trend in the economy and the policy implications. I'm going to come at it from a somewhat different way, but that's a good thing because since our policymakers did not understand, to put it bluntly, what drives economic growth in a modern economy, then the more we say this, the better. This first slide actually sums up pretty much the major points I want to make. It's a comparison and a contrast between what I call macro stabilization policies. You know them as monetary and fiscal policies. So fiscal policy, the objective is to stimulate demand. That's the Keynesian approach. Monetary policy, by lowering the cost of capital, you induce investment. The whole neoclassical traditional economic growth theory is based on the accumulation of capital in response to price signals. So this is not just largely, it's an entirely private sector phenomenon. And so if the price signals say in one part of the economy more assets should be accumulated there, then the traditional economic growth theory says that will happen. The only thing government needs to do is create a general environment that allows companies to react to these price signals. So the role of technology gets involved here in a very simplistic way. It's assumed to be a private good, like any other type of investment. So if the price signals warrant that new capital be invested in embodying some new technology, it sort of automatically happens. And well, I'm here to say that this is a long ways from the truth. And another major point about these monetary and fiscal policies, which, as you know, when you cannot pick up a financial publication or turn on a financial news network or even the general media these days, you hear these debates about how much fiscal policy, how much monetary policy, and nothing is really said about the structure of the economy. Every once in a while, you'll hear an economist or a financial analyst on Wall Street say, well, there's structural problems this time. But when you look into what they really mean, they're talking about the excessive debt burden, for example. The major asset categories that drive an economy are absolutely off the table. In this traditional model, when investment occurs, that's the driver of growth. The multiplier effect kicks in and the economy is moved from whatever disequilibrium position it's in, too much excess growth, or in the case of recession, not enough, back towards the long-term growth track. But what these macro models do not say is what determines the growth track. In the microeconomic side, however, and these are the minority of economists, the couple of significant differences that actually focus on this growth track. The dynamics of a modern economy is much more important, namely that change does occur, and this change has a cyclical pattern to it. For example, technologies are created, they expand their market influence, they mature, and then they decline. So there's change going on within the life cycle, and then there's a big change that occurs between life cycles. And this is an incredibly important characteristic of a modern economy, and one in which Western economies, although they acknowledge it in terms of relative allocation to managing this change, for the most part, way under what would be the optimal level. In contrast, we see in the Asian economies much more investment in these what I call structural assets. So this diagram is a way of contrasting the macro stabilization policies with the more microeconomic technology-based growth policies. The blue lines here represent long-term growth tracks, which again is determined by a set of investments that an economy makes in the assets that drive growth. The dashed red lines, that's the business cycle. So no economy grows in a straight line. This is a simplification. It's a smooth trend. You get these ups and downs, and that's what the monetary and fiscal policy is designed to do. They are short-term stabilization policies. There's almost nothing embodied in those policy instruments that can determine long-run growth. Yet, this is exactly the way it's proposed and discussed among economists. And of course, because the traditional neoclassical economists are in the majority still, they're the ones that get all the high-ranking policy positions. The head of the CEA, the head of the National Economic Council, the White House, it makes no difference whether it's Republican or Democrat. They're all in this traditional mode. Rob mentioned Larry Summers, for example. You may read Paul Krugman's op-eds in the New York Times. It's either a Keynesian approach or it's the supply-side economics where it's all about investment by the private sector. The other characteristic of these growth trends is that when an economy invests in the right set of assets, the business cycle fluctuations are more mild, which I've attempted to illustrate here in this diagram. Their recessions are less frequent and they're more easily dealt with. On the other hand, if there's underinvestment in the structural assets of an economy, then you find a much wider swing in the business cycle. And every once in a while, there's a confluence of events as we're experiencing now. And you see something here like the Great Recession, where the business cycle is well below the growth track and it's uncertain when we'll get back to it. Now, Rob mentioned one estimate it could take until 2023 to get employment back to the pre-recession level. So the implication here is that we need a different growth strategy. But this is somewhat complementary to what Rob was saying, if you have a structurally weak economy, it certainly becomes evident after a period of time, and now is the time for the U.S. economy. The average real GDP growth is 1.7% in the last decade. That is a third of the average annual real growth rate in GDP in the previous three decades. U.S. private non-farm employment fell 3.3%, and median household real income fell 7%. Now, these are unprecedented statistics for any decade since the Great Depression. You hear all this consternation in the press about, well, the economy's not going to recover until the housing industry comes back, and it's not coming back. Well, it's never going to come back when real income is declining. History shows that housing prices track real income. But, as I said, what happens when you turn on the TV or pick up the newspapers, it's all about government spending versus deficit reduction on the fiscal side, and then it's monetary base expansion versus potential inflation effects of too much expansion on the monetary policy side. When we should be paying attention here to the set of assets that are all essential to moving that blue line in the previous diagram to a steeper slope. In other words, a higher long-term growth track. But our strategic response has been to accumulate debt, and Rob referred to this as well. The amount of debt we accumulated in the last decade is mind-boggling. American households, as this shows, increased their debt by 75%, state and local governments by 89%, and the federal government by a whopping 178% in just one decade. And also, economists will say that when an economy gets in trouble, one way to at least mitigate the decline and to at least buy some time while you make the structural changes is to depreciate your currency. Now, you know there's a huge furor ongoing about the Chinese manipulating their currency, undervaluing it in order to adopt, Rob has preached about this many times, their mercantilist approach to growth, exporting at other countries' expense. But what is surprisingly to me ignored is over the past decade, our currency against the basket of the major trading partners has declined 34%. Yet our trade deficit continues to decline. So
there, the trade deficit grows.
Yeah.
You said decline.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It grows. Trade deficit
trade
grows.
Balance declines. Thank you. So what we have to do is get this growth policy correct. Now, our friend Fed Chairman Bernanke actually has made a very useful point here by emphasizing the difference in that a small change in GDP growth, and again going back to that earlier diagram, the slope of those blue lines will make in living standards. 2.5% per year growth doubles the per capita GDP, which is our measure of standard of living, in about one generation, 28 years. If you take that growth rate and reduce it by just one percentage point to 1.5%, It basically takes 47 years by the Fed's estimate to double living standards. That's roughly two generations versus one for the 2.5% growth rate. And 1.5% really is about the best we can expect here in the next few years. And if Europe doesn't get its act together, we won't even see that, I believe. And I don't see any reason why this economy cannot grow 5 to 6%. Real growth every year if we make the investments in those five categories that I showed you on a previous slide. And our leaders are saying the right words. All Fed Chairman Bernanke, Treasury Secretary Geithner, and the President's second innovation statement released last year, they all say innovation is critical to our competitiveness and our growth. But show me the money. The question is, where's the investment that's going to make that happen? Now, this chart, some of you may have seen it before, but this has been modified. I think this is a very telling example of the impact that increased investment can have I took the manufacturing sector and I divided it into R&D intensive and non-R&D intensive groups. And you can see that the huge difference in the average R&D intensity. In the period 2000 to 2007, which does not include the Great Recession, of course, we had a very healthy growth rate and real output, almost no growth in the non-R&D intensive sector. And recently, I was able to get updated data from BLS. So now, here's the impact of the recession. From 2000 to 2009, the growth rate, although it changed among industries in the R&D intensive sector, the average was almost the same. Incredible. But look what happened to the non-R&D intensive portion of manufacturing, a substantial decline. I don't know what it's going to take to get the message across, but so far it's not happening. Here is an example of how it can happen. Germany. This was inspired by the ITF seminar about a month ago when our German colleagues came over and talked about their science and technology related programs. And out of that, I called this characterization of the German economy. They have a trade surplus in manufacturing, whereas the United States has not had a trade surplus in manufacturing since 1975. Okay, 35 years. But they are doing this with a 9% lower R&D intensity for their economy, 39% higher hourly manufacturing labor compensation, and a 12% higher corporate tax rate. Well, in my opinion, the way they are doing this, in the second bullet, they're obsessed with labor skills and how labor and capital are combined to grow productivity. They've optimized their industry structure, meaning they understand the complementary effects of small, large, and medium firms in the same industry or sector. And as a result, they've ended up with the highest percentage of their manufacturing value added that comes from R&D intensive industries. And that's important because that implies a more stable competitive position going forward. And sure enough, their performance in terms of trade surplus shows it. Yeah, I'm almost done. So, Rob also mentioned the American Recovery and Investment Act, $787 billion. I went through it to see how much investment might really be in it, because fiscal policy actually can be an investment vehicle. The problem is when it's fiscal policy from a stabilization point of view, it's very short term. That's what the term shovel ready means. You heard that, the president said it, others have said it. $105 billion was actually allocated to traditional economic infrastructure, which is one of the many areas of investment we've neglected. There was a target on energy. There was a $49 billion there at infrastructure and what we call energy efficiency, including a small amount for R&D. Only $7.6 billion allocated to scientific research. So, and this chart is, if you had to describe the policy, the growth policy targets, there would be three types of efficiency. You can see where I got this at the bottom. Excellent report by Rob and his scholar, Dave Odrich. Allocative efficiency, that's the classical model we discussed at the beginning. Allocative efficiency in the neoclassical model simply means responding to prices, accumulating capital. Productive efficiency, again, as long as there's a competitive environment, traditional economics says companies, by competing against each other, will achieve that. But what they ignore is the third one, which is the increasing impact of technology on changing the relative productivities of assets over time. So, the last slide. You need a model that incorporates the complexity of technology. And this is the one that I've pushed for some time. Instead of looking at technology as a purely private good, the black box, as the traditional economists characterize it, I've broken it out into three major elements that respond to very different investment incentives. The point is that the blue shading is public good content. And some of our policy responses these days include the term partnerships. And it's a motherhood and apple pie term. Everybody's jumped on it. The president has several partnership type initiatives. But if you took a poll of all the people pushing that and asked them what's the economic rationale for it, I have yet to find anybody that can really articulate it all that clearly. But it comes from the fact that the two elements of the typical industrial technology, generic technology and infra technology, had public good content. So it would take a long time to go into that. But the point is that look at all these policy responses that this model allows you to see where the targets are. The traditional economic growth model ignores all of this. Not necessary. So, I saw this quote recently by a Wall Street money manager. His fund looks at emerging trends, and so they're very conscious of how the world's changing. He has a very pessimistic view. I'm not sure I'm willing to quite subscribe to that yet, but it's something to think about. Thank you.
Okay, we're going to hold the question until we get to the end.
Thanks. Oops. Thanks, Robin. It's great to be here on a panel with someone as distinguished as Greg as well, and it's always a pleasure to come here because it's one of the few places I split my time between Silicon Valley and Washington, D.C., where there's actually a real conversation about the fundamental challenges facing the country. And every time I participate in an event here, I always feel like telling people, just do what Rob says. That's the right answer. So I want to hopefully complement some of what Rob and Greg have been saying by coming at this from a perspective of some work that we've been doing over several years at the McKinsey Global Institute, particularly looking at the more fundamental issues facing the country. We obviously have some normal cyclical issues, but we share the perspective that there is something much more fundamental and structural underlying the challenges that we're facing. And what I really want to talk about is, oops, wrong button.
Side button.
This one. Alexis, do you want to can you do this?
Yeah.
Right. Well, I'll keep talking. This is just a set of pages. So I'm going to talk about the productivity challenge facing the country, which is really what's powered, in many ways, the growth and competitiveness and rising living standards of the country. I want to then talk a little bit about how that relates to the current job challenge and conclude with what we've really got is a innovation and competitiveness challenge and some of the issues around what we might be able to do about that.
Alexis got the fixes.
Okay. So, One way to think about this is that GDP growth comes from two sources. One is increasing the number of workers, and two, boosting the amount that each worker produces. Of these two, the former drove much of the growth in GDP in the U.S. for decades. It was most pronounced in the 70s when women first joined the workforce in large numbers and when baby boomers came of age. In that decade, productivity growth as a percentage of the total GDP growth was only 35%. But starting in the 90s, that trend reversed in this country. Female labor force participation plateaued. Baby boomers began to retire if they could. And we could no longer support GDP growth by expecting it to come from labor pool growth. And
there we go.
So in the 2000s, productivity growth accounted for a full 80% of the total GDP growth, and we have every expectation that's going to continue going forward. So the U.S., if it's going to grow GDP, which we think is essential, obviously, it's going to have to come from productivity improvements, and other than cyclical adjustment, a very small percentage increase in the labor force. Oh, this is just awful. I didn't look at these before they came up. Sorry about that. So if that seems challenging, so does the price of not doing it right. Those who were born in the 60s and 50s, like me, were fortunate to see our living standards increase 2.5 times and just after between when we were born and the turn of the century. So it's working on that. If you look over there, you can see it. For some reason, it's not showing up right on this one. I don't know why. But to regain the GDP growth that we've had in the last two decades, labor productivity is going to have to increase from 1.7% to 2.3% over the next decade, an acceleration of 34% to a rate that we haven't seen since the 1960s. So we really do face a daunting productivity challenge. GDP is only going to grow if we have productivity growth, and we are going to need to increase that pretty dramatically, something like by a third over the course of the next decade, if we're going to have the same expectations for standard of livings that we've had in the past. Now, let me quickly turn to jobs. This is the same, it's very similar chart to what Rob showed. Obviously, this is a deep and long recession, but it's not that this is the first time we're seeing this. It's just getting worse. If starting with the 1948 recession and going up through the one up to 2000, it generally took between 4 to 6 months for the economy to recover from the decline back to full employment. But after the 1990 recession, it took 15 months. The 2001 recession was 39 months, and who knows how long it's going to be today, but it's certainly not a kind of trend that we'd like to see. So what is it that's driving that? Among other things, we're seeing a changing nature of the ability of the workforce to respond to these downturns. In today's globally competitive environment, companies are trying to be more productive. We also find mismatch between where the jobs are and where people live, and a mismatch between the skills that workers have and the skills that people need. So at a time where we need more mobility, they seem to be stuck in place. So thanks to higher levels of home ownership and a housing crisis that makes many of them impossible to sell, labor mobility is actually at a 50-year low. That's the first mismatch I mentioned. The second is the jobs and skills mismatch, where job openings exist. They're still unable to fill them in it. But as Rob said, that's getting worse. It's not the core element of it, but it's a big problem. Despite 9% unemployment, when we surveyed workers, 40% of companies said that they plan to hire in the next 12 months, but they've had positions open for 6 months or longer because they can't find the right people with the specific skills and qualifications. I actually think this is not a cyclical issue. This is actually more fundamental of a competitiveness challenge, as we haven't had a highly productive K-12 work education system for quite a while. So let me be a little more sobering about this. We looked in depth at six major sectors in the economy to try and forecast what we think might happen. We looked at ways that job creation might be different in the past than it is in the future than it was in the past. And our estimate is that if we're going to get back to full employment, we're going to need to create something like 21 million jobs to get to full employment. And only the absolutely high end of any of projections that we can believe said that's possible, certainly by 2020. So as Rob said in Laura's prediction, it may be more like 2023. That includes replacing the 7 million jobs that were lost in the recession and providing work for the more than 14 million new entrants that will be in the labor force by then. Now, that is obviously a big problem, and the low end of the scenarios gives us a repeat of the last decade, a challenge that a movie that I don't think any of us want to repeat. So that brings me to the third challenge. To regain growth and employment rates in this country, we really need to see a burst in innovation. The productivity improvement that I described can either come from efficiency gains, replacing inputs for a given output, or by increasing the volume and value of outputs for the same input. And the productivity and acceleration, rapid growth in GDP in the United States in the second half of the 1990s was enabled by solid gains in both sources. Three sectors, retail, very high-end productivity, semiconductors, and electronics, contributed 45% of that acceleration in productivity, but also added more than 2 million jobs during that time frame. So that's the picture. It's a complicated chart, but that was what happened in the 1990s. The problem was, in the 2000s, productivity gains came from sectors that experienced employment declines. So we had an efficiency-oriented productivity improvement rather than an innovation-oriented improvement.
I mean, is the title of that, should that be 2000 to 2010 on the top?
Yes, sorry. The prior one was 90 to 2000. That one should be 2000 to 2010. Sorry about that.
Are we going to get to see these charts? I mean, are they going to be online?
Yeah.
And you'll correct them?
Yeah.
We'll fix that. They'll cut the layers. Yeah, that'll be on our website.
So let me just flip back. So that's what it was in the 1990s. You want things in the upper right-hand corner that have both employment growth and value-added growth, not the 2000s, where there was some productivity growth lower, but a lot of it coming from employment declines and efficiency gains. So really what we need is a much broader-based productivity improvement, more like what we saw in the 1990s that has innovation at its core, not just efficiency. And so, again, I'm not going to go through all of these in detail. All this is on our website. Some of this is in the material that's back there, but it's all on the website. But we do think this is not impossible. We think that we can achieve those historic levels of GDP growth that's going to keep our economy growing. And we think that there's a fair amount of that's possible just by application of existing best practices, not necessarily dramatic new innovation. And we're talking about the standard transfer of something that somebody's doing well in one portion of an industry across the industry or from other industries to there. And it's actually something that American companies are generally pretty good at. As an example, the application of lean operations was an important part of the story in retail, but it hasn't been applied across a large number of other sectors. As an example, on-time delivery rates in automobile industry are about 95% in this country. On-time delivery rates for aerospace are about 70%. So there are some opportunities to apply what is working one place in another place. Next wave innovation can also fuel gains. I don't have time to go into detail here, but we are quite optimistic about the potential that internet-driven productivity gains such as consumer engagement, cloud computing, and social mobility, social media have to be applied to commercial businesses, not just allowing you to look at great pictures of your kids and grandkids on Facebook. We think that will have a lot of opportunity in the next decade as companies start to apply that technology to their operations. But there is the whole, at least a quarter of this innovation and potentially more that's going to need to come from government and government-related business interactions. We can't get from here to that level of productivity improvement just by applying what is known or applying technologies that are already in the pipeline. So let me quickly conclude, and then so we have time for commentary. Global Institute's not really a policy shop. We're more providing analytic support for folks who are designing the policy choices, but we do think that there are four important categories of things that are going to be necessary if we're going to work our way out of this challenge that I described of both ensuring that we have productivity increase and innovation that drives that productivity. First is that we really are going to have to increase the spark. That's new job creation, new business creation, and scaling of new businesses. The decline in the number of startups in this country since the beginning of the Great Recession was 23%. And if we'd had the same level of increase in startups that we had before and the average number of jobs per startup, we'd have had 1.8 million more people employed in this country. So it is important to regenerate that engine of productivity. Secondly, we're going to have to understand that in this world of traded goods, we have to compete on skills. We need to ensure that Americans have the skills that match employer needs for tomorrow, not just the needs of yesterday, and that they are constantly refreshed over time. Our estimate, for example, is that the cost of the achievement gap in K-12 education in the United States, the economic cost of underperforming kids in our K-12 system, is the equivalent of a permanent national recession. Depending on how you calculate it, the order of magnitude is somewhere between $500 and $800 billion a year of drag because we're not performing at the level that we should be. Third, we're going to have to increase share. The globalization is going to create jobs and create growth. The developing markets are going to continue to grow. U.S. companies, for the most part, have adapted and performed in that environment, but the same can't be said for U.S. workers. I'm not talking about enacting tariffs or quotas or protective trade policies, but we do have to start thinking about a policy that is competitiveness that works for jobs and not just for the U.S. economy and GDP overall. And then finally, we do think it's important to improve the speed with which we operate, removing impediments to investment, productivity, and job creation. And I'm not talking about cutting regulations. I do think, however, that there is an opportunity to what I was talking about earlier in terms of applying lean principles. One place that we should be applying that is in the regulatory process. You can leave the exact same level of standards, but make speed and certainty a much higher objective function for that and get a major improvement in U.S. performance. So let me stop at that and turn it back to questions. Again, as I said, all these are on the web if you want.
Okay, excellent. All right, well, thank you both. Those are great comments. And just to confirm your view about skills mismatch, which we agree is partly there, it's not the only factor. But we have a skills mismatch. We've actually had a job opening for over a year, and we're willing to do our part to bring down the unemployment rate of the U.S. And hire someone at a good wage job, but unfortunately, it's a null set as far as I can tell. It has to. I think Greg is the only one in the set as far as I can tell. You want to work for me, Greg? It's an economist who understands innovation. So far, that's been a null set. So why don't we open it up? I want to go, because this gentleman, you had your hand up first.
Hi, I felt it.
Yeah, go ahead.
I want to address Dr. Atkinson's presentation and suggest that with all of the discussion lately
sure.
about
Could
the health...
Could you state your name? Sorry.
I'm sorry. Cliff Waldman with MAPI.
Thank you.
Manufacturers Alliance MAPI. With all the discussion lately about the health of the manufacturing sector, which is what I focus on, there's been very little talk about manufacturing entrepreneurship. We talk about the policies, corporate tax rates, currency alignments, all that affect current manufacturing firms, and that's obviously important. But if you're worried about the health of a sector, you have to worry about, you know, the population, you know, the renewal of the population. And I think if jobs are the order of the day, I think probably, I'm postulating, I don't have evidence, but I'm postulating that new manufacturing firms probably are the ones that grow faster than others because of scale economies and create a lot of jobs in doing that. Very little discussion out there. I can't even find a paper on talking about entrepreneurship in manufacturing, combining your barbershop slide with your affordable goods slide, put it that way. And I think more has to be focused on that. I mean, what would be your response to that?
Well, I 100% agree. There's a report we did earlier this year called The Case for a National Manufacturing Strategy, and it's on our website. You might want to look at it. But there's a chart in there that looks at the dynamic change of jobs in manufacturing, how much is coming from contraction versus new firms. And the new firm formation in manufacturing is significantly down. It goes along with Lenny's point. So absolutely. Again, no, I think it's a combination of you have to make sure existing firms can grow and retain, and obviously you have to get more new firm formation. I think that part of that is we've got a better climate here to when we spin off companies. A lot of times the spin-offs will occur, but the manufacturing gets done overseas. So there are new firms. They just aren't here. Anybody wants to add to that, Greg? Just press it.
I got it. I had an opportunity this summer to give a talk at a conference on in California on nanomanufacturing, and there were a large number of small startups represented there, including, in almost in every case, including some university people who had become part of the startup. So I was asking questions along the lines of your concern about how much access to capital do they have, what about the skill mix that they need, and other issues associated with growing. For example, when you have your first product, how do you acquire manufacturing skills? You may be good at inventing, but you also need to be able to produce it with a consistent level of quality at a price that allows you to penetrate the market. So, interestingly, a lot of the normal factors were about trouble getting funding and whatever came up. But one point that was pretty consistent was the environment in which they as entrepreneurs were made a huge difference in their ability to progress. And by that I mean being in a region where they had access to skilled labor pools, to venture capital was sensitive to the area of technology they were in, to the state-related training programs, like entrepreneurship training programs a lot of universities now have, and the ability to interact with companies in the supply chain with whom they could partner, they could learn, they could eventually become suppliers. And so all this leads to this emerging model of clusters. And, you know, once again, we have a couple of examples around this country that for different reasons have sprung up. The nanoscience and technology cluster around Albany is a great example, but there's some unique aspects to that, such as the supply chain already existed because IBM has been in the Hudson River Valley for decades. Other countries have a much more aggressive, conscious approach to promoting this sort of cluster environment. The federal government is just now beginning to think about this, and we have a few, you know, relatively modest programs in the offering. But that's the way we're going to have to go, because individual companies in today's highly competitive, very dynamic global marketplace, they're not going to make it on their own. You know, the days of inventing something in a garage and then going out and, oh, yeah, sure, no problem, venture capital, and before you know it, your Apple computer, it's going to be more and more difficult to do that for a whole range of reasons. So it's, you know, one of my five asset categories is institutional. This is it.
I'm Mitzi Wirth. I'm at the Naval Postgraduate School. And as I listen to the three of you talk, the thing that I'm struck by and I think is really missing in our thinking is design theory. How are these systems designed? What are these systems? And what are the processes? And we have an educational system that gets us down with the laser. Higher up you go, the narrower you look at the world. And yet this is all about being connected. And if you don't understand how the processes work, I mean, I used to work for IBM, and I know that they have all that kind of resource, human capital resource there, but it's not the thing most people think about if they haven't, and we don't educate, and if you try to get any of these academic institutions to even think about it, they just push you away because it would mean more learning. And if you've had tenure, you're not required to come up with any new ideas. All you have to do is regurgitate what you wrote in your thesis. So we have some real impediments in what the structure looks like, and it's through many, many domains. And we don't build in a mechanism for going back and looking at the structure to say, does this still make any sense? We have no self-correcting. You have self-correcting.
Right, so let me respond to that. Yeah. So I think one of the best places in the country now that is doing that is a place up in Boston called Olin College. So we wrote a recent report on STEM education reform where we actually had almost a whole chapter devoted to Olin. It wasn't quite that much. But Olin is a very interesting place because about a decade ago, to respond, I think, to what you're saying, Mitzi, a bunch of engineering leaders in this country came together and said, we don't think the engineering education system is doing a good job of preparing engineers for the 21st century economy. So they created Olin, and it's at a four-year school, undergrad, only engineering, but there's no tenure. And there are no departments. So it gets to your point about you can't get in your stovepipe. And the other thing about Olin is you don't just learn engineering, you learn three things. You learn engineering, design, and business together. And everything is related to those three things. We estimated, my colleague Marilee Mayo and I in this report, we estimated, given the fact that Olin is only 10 years old, if you control for age of the institution, they are on track to produce twice as many new technology business startups as MIT. So the amount of new startups coming out of Olin by these 23-year-old kids is really phenomenal, because the entire education process is about how you put design, business, and engineering together. So there are models. Now, one of the things actually interesting, Lenny, you had some experience at Stanford. Stanford actually asked Olin to go out and do a partnership with Stanford. Talk about the mouse and the lion. Because Stanford has a business school, a design school, and an engineering school that don't do anything together, and now they're looking to little Olin to figure out how they can combine that. U of I in Champaign is doing the same thing. So our view is one of the real key roles the federal government could play through NSF, through what's called IGERT, institutional, anybody know what IGERT is? Graduate Research, Education, and Training.
Isn't it?
Pardon?
Integrative.
So we have a little program at NSF which is all about integrative learning in systems like that, but it's vastly underfunded and it doesn't really have the scale at which it needs.
But it doesn't get written about.
No, I agree.
And if you don't start creating a demand for it, I mean, all these schools ought to be doing it. Arizona State University got rid of all their departments as well.
Right. So any other comments?
Yeah. There is smaller scale examples of this going on. The D school at Stanford now, which is the reason it happened, is because Heino Plaster from SAP funded an institute. And so, unfortunately, the only way these are happening is outside the existing architectures. But there are really interesting things going on at those intersections. And the real challenge is, how do we scale them so that just doesn't become three little isolated pools around the country, but
speed
much less.
Scale.
I want to keep going here. So I'll go here and then here. So
Chris. I'm Chris Hill, a consultant at George Mason. I wanted to ask Lenny, I guess, because you seem to be most congenial to the question, about the housing market. Which does contribute to that worker lockup you talked about. It's also a reason that, you know, there's no construction activity now because so many people are locked into mortgages they can't get out of. And so when we dismiss, as maybe too strong, their colleagues on the panel too, the macro influences of the financial crisis, isn't that, for one thing, ignoring the problems in the housing market and that are structural in that market that we really desperately need to deal with? For we can't really expect innovation, invention, and job creation, and startups and the like to really break things loose unless we deal with some of the more traditionally oriented financial crisis.
I think the housing overhang is a huge deterrent. It's not something that's going to happen very quickly. We've built enough houses in most parts of the country, where particularly where the overhang is, for a decade. And there are a number of challenges with trying to turn that around more quickly. But what happened, I mean, we overinvested in residential real estate, and that's a lot of where that investment came. And it has both first order consequences in terms of fiscal and in terms of macroeconomic implications. But it has a second order set of implications. It's one of the important reasons why there's less labor mobility. If you are underwater in your house and you're relying on your spouse's health insurance, nobody's going to move. Secondly, a lot of why there's been a decline in startup activity is, despite the fact that it's technically debt, it's actually equity. It's technically equity, but it's debt because it was home equity loans or credit cards, and those are much less available. So I think it is a problem. I don't think there's an easy solution, though. We're going to have to work through it for that overhang.
So I think this is an excellent example of what I was saying about the misallocation of resources. For the past several decades, we as a country have done absolutely everything possible to make our citizens overinvest in housing. Tax preference on the way in, tax preference during the holding period, tax preference on the way out. So ask yourself, what has the largest multiplier, investment in housing or investment in semiconductor technology? So we're all complaining to the macroeconomists about how monetary and fiscal policy is not working because it's not reestablishing growth in the housing sector. And I'm not saying that we don't want a healthy housing sector, but the fact we focus on that and ignore the investment in productivity-enhancing assets, that's the problem.
Pass.
My name is Leo Schmeikowski, Bureau of Labor Statistics. I've heard a lot about innovation, but it seems that the fundamental problem is not so much that the United States is not innovative enough, but the innovations are copied much more frequently, much sooner in foreign countries. As Larry Summers said, when Kodak had new technology, Rochester was prosperous for a couple of generations. When Steve Jobs had a new product in Apple, it's all produced in China. So no matter how much new technology we invest in innovation, as long as it's copied very quickly, immediately by other countries, we're not going to gain a competitive advantage from it. So what can be done to try to hold the technology more in this country so that more Americans benefit from it and the United States benefits longer from that? And maybe there should be some sort of restrictions on U.S. multinationals transferring technology abroad. Maybe the workers should, like in Germany, should get more influence on corporate decisions, so that the corporations aren't so eager to outsource their technology to other countries?
Well, I mean, I strongly disagree with any of those proposals come up in Congress to try to restrict. If you get government funding for R&D, you must manufacture here. You know what will happen? Those multinationals will just take all the R&D overseas if you try to place that kind of restriction on them, because they have other options. Increasingly, they have other options. So the thing to realize is that the transfer of technical knowledge is neither instant nor costless. So if you keep innovating, you stay ahead. You saw the data I showed on the German economy. If you looked at their labor costs and their R&D intensity and their corporate tax rate, you never expect them to have a trade surplus. But because they focus, they are obsessed with productivity, they have trade surpluses. So there is no reason why this country cannot have a trade surplus in high-tech products, no matter how pervasive the competition is elsewhere. It's just up to us to do it better.
I guess I would add to that, I mean, we've written extensively on that on the website, but first of all, I guess a couple things. One, we don't define innovation as the early stage of the process alone. Innovation is everything from conception all the way to production, so it's all that, but that may just be a semantic issue. But it's not as if this stuff automatically gets copied. Most of the copying, a large share of the copying is illegal, is unethical, is forced. There are many U.S. companies that don't want to put high-skill, high-tech production in China, but they do because that's the only way they can get market access, which is illegal under the WTO, but we don't bother to bring any cases against it. So yeah, of course technology moves, particularly as you get later in the product life cycle, but we have to do more to sort of slow that down to what is a normal market function as opposed to a hyper-government mercantilist function, which is what's happening now. Second thing, I agree with Greg on the restrictions. What we can do is we need to have much stronger incentives for producing here. Other countries have put in place tax incentives, for example, for investing in new capital equipment. We don't really do that. In fact, the current tax debate now in Washington is, if I were a betting person, I would bet that if we do corporate tax reform, it will end up with weaker incentives to produce in the U.S. than stronger incentives. Because the mantra of corporate tax reform is driven, as Greg talked about, by neoclassical economists who don't want any allocation influenced by the tax code. So they, actually Larry Summers is a great example. Larry Summers recently, about 20 years ago, 30 years ago, wrote a very seminal report, a seminal article, where he argued against an investment tax credit for manufacturing, actually overall investment credit, even though in his DRI model you had higher productivity growth through the economy, you had more capital investment, and you had higher GDP growth if you did this investment tax credit. He said no, get rid of the investment tax credit, because interest rates got bid up slightly because there's so much demand for real capital that housing starts went down by a tad. Larry Summers called this inappropriate industrial policy, where the government is picking assets around allocation, to Greg's point, and therefore we don't have an investment tax credit. So I think we can and should do a lot more of what you're saying. So maybe the gentleman right back there, and then here, and then we'll wrap it up.
James Henning, IBM Research, retired. But both Greg and Lenny, you pointed out that there are some sectors in the United States economies that are very innovative, semiconductors, communications. But you also pointed out that there are some sectors that lag, healthcare and energy. And they seem to have some substantially different characteristics, like very large initial capital investment, long depreciation schedules. Is there anything wrong with the way we scale things if we try to, we are trying to scale things if we use the examples of, from semiconductors and software to turbines and nuclear power plants?
So I wrote a piece that's on our website with Laura Tyson on four anchors holding back the U.S. economy. And there were four sectors that have a set of things in common. The lowest investment in R&D, lowest investment in information technology, the lowest level of innovation and generally performance, the lowest level of productivity growth, and sets of industrial characteristics around them that make it very hard to get the competitive environment that happens in other sectors that would do that. Healthcare, education, infrastructure, and public services. And each of those have a drag on the economy of several hundred billion dollars. And unless we find a way to have those sectors have innovation, investment in R&D, investment in information technology, more productivity improvement. The private sector for the rest of those non-tradable sectors cannot sustain the growth necessary to pull those four anchors along. So I think those are huge problems. I'm optimistic that it's possible, though. There are, while that's true on average, if you look at the more micro level, there are places within this country on each of those where we have the most innovative and productive places. It's a problem about scaling.
What were those four sectors?
Healthcare, education, infrastructure, and public delivery of services.
By infrastructure, does that include energy?
Yes.
I want to see if we have a couple more people who still have hands up. Yes, sir.
Just a question. But finally, advanced nuclear reactors. My concern is, in all this discussion, I don't know if there's still an appropriate level of focus on what I would consider the fundamentals, right? We talk a lot about what the government can do to help in this process, but I don't know that we've fully understood or discussed publicly the other side of globalization. And specifically what I mean is, as long as I, as the owner of a company, can realistically hire an engineer in China for $7,000 as compared to $70,000 in the US, I have a built-in incentive to go to China. And quantitatively, I've never heard a discussion of how, through a combination of government initiatives and otherwise, we can bridge the gap between $7,000 and $70,000. And what started off as a feature of the manufacturing environment has now extended to other areas as well. Similarly, you have an instance now where a lot of the legal firms are outsourcing a lot of the basic legal work to places like India. And again, the dynamics are, in India you can get someone who charges $40 an hour who can do a lot of the work that in the US used to cost $400 an hour. So there's still not, I don't think, and maybe I've missed it, enough discussion on how we quantitatively bridge and overcome a gap as large as that. And unless there's some constraints placed through government policy, then and as you said, maybe government-sponsored R&D cannot go overseas, but then that leads to other market inefficiencies. So unless there's a quantitative discussion on how we bridge that gap, I don't know how we solve this problem.
So I think two things. One is, from an economic theory point of view, and there is something valid about economic theory once in a while, it's like a clock that's broken, once in a while it's right. There is no inherent reason why any country must run a trade surplus or a trade deficit, even with incredibly low wages. And the reason is, in part, because currency and other factors equilibrate. What really should be happening with China and India, China in particular, India is much less of a problem, is that certain types of skills and jobs go over there, and then we move up the value chain and do others. But so I guess it doesn't, in some ways it doesn't make any difference what their price of labor is. Their price of labor could be zero and shouldn't make a difference as long as you let other factors equilibrate. One of the problems with the Chinese won't do that. They won't let their currency adjust, and they are putting massive subsidies to gain even more unfair competitive advantage. And then the other problem is, Greg and Lenny have talked about, we don't do enough to keep going out onto the frontier and doing things the Chinese can't do. So I don't think there's any inherent reason we can't, the Germans run a trade surplus with the Chinese. I don't think there's any inherent reason we can't do it.
Well, let's just assume in your example that the $7,000 scientist engineer has exactly the same skills as the $70,000 one in the US. It still counts a lot, the environment in which each of those two workers is embedded in terms of the support structure, the capital, the equipment, how they're integrated into a company and in turn that company into not just an industry but a supply chain. I don't know if any of you saw the recent article in The Economist where they did a pretty intensive study of the innovativeness using patents, and patents are really an estimate. Indicator of invention as opposed to innovation, but China came out way down. They had a lot of patents, but they were weak patents. And so my point is that it's more than just individuals and even relative wage differences. I mean, they count for something, but you have to have the whole package or no high-tech company is going to move to that particular environment.
Right. And if I just, I mean, I'm assuming fixed costs are the same. It's just on variable costs.
Yeah. So I want to have one last question. So David, then we'll wrap
David
up.
Michelle, CSC, sort of building on that same issue. You know, Steve Jobs, who knows a bit about building things, was a pretty pro-U.S. guy and really didn't like the idea that all his products were built in China at all. In fact, legend has it he really hated to go there, and that's another story. But the reason he didn't build the products in the U.S., which he would like to do, was not so much about wages, although clearly that was part of it. It was simply he couldn't find the hundreds or even thousands of mid-level engineers you would need to do it, and he couldn't get the permits in place to build on the scale that they wanted to do as quickly as they wanted to do, and it just wasn't physically doable to do what he needed to do with what we had here, and so he essentially had to do it.
Yeah, although I think that one of the big problems we have, and I think it really goes to Greg's point, is we tend to assume these problems are solved by individual firms acting alone in markets. And what Apple was facing was a system problem. Is they had that problem because other firms had made choices about where supply chains were located, which in turn influenced the demand side on the labor market for engineers. And so they had this entire sort of diminution of the innovation production ecosystem, and then the next decision that gets made is, I can't do it here, so I'm going offshore, which suggests to us, or me, that we can't solve the problem by just waiting on individual firms. Individual firms make rational decisions that are bad for the system sometimes, and sometimes they're good. We've got to have a system response, and so that system response to us is you have to find, we've got to do a much better job of training mid-level engineers and better mechanical and more mechanical electrical. We got to do a better job with tax policy to incent these kinds of decisions here. We got to do a better job with innovation and production clusters. We got to do a better job with overall technician skills like the Germans do. So there's a lot of different pieces to this ecosystem, and I guess maybe the one lesson maybe I'll assert that we would all agree with is we have to have a comprehensive policy response to this. We can't do one-offs. The only way we get to this next level of equilibrium is with a comprehensive solution. So I'll let Greg and Lenny have the last word, and then we'll wrap up if there's any last word you wanted to offer.
Buy low, sell high.
Can you just tell us which stocks that would be?
That's a tough one.
The whole system.
No, but we've mentioned several times the post-innovation issues is something else, again, that we've ignored, and it shows how badly as a country we understand this when you look at what's happened in the Department of Energy recently or with Solyndra and others. Andy Grove, former CEO of Intel, excellent editorial op-ed in Business Week about a year or so ago, and he made that point. Other corporate CEOs have said the same thing, namely, we're ignoring scale-up. In this country, again, it's this black box model, as I call it, where we think that if you just leave the entrepreneurs alone, they'll innovate, and then you know, it's if you build a better mousetrap, the world will be the path to your door type of thinking, that automatically venture capital flows in, and you get scale up, and pretty soon you have a new industry. It's not that simple. And so, again, following up on what Rob's saying, we need a much more comprehensive view of the entire technology life cycle. And that's number one. Number two, industry is no longer the target of policy, has to be the supply chain. And we're finding out painfully what happens when not only do you have to worry about entrepreneurs embedded in industries, you have to worry about industries embedded in supply chains. And that's why what we see in the Hudson River Valley is such a great model, because it's a whole supply chain. And as a result, it'll be successful. But unless we replicate that over and over and over again across the country, we won't get the aggregate economic growth.
Great, thank you.
And just say we really do need to have an honest conversation with real facts and about what is really going on with competitiveness of the U.S. economy and all the dimensions that we're talking about. Taking for granted that in the past the U.S. was the largest economy and among the fastest growing in terms of aggregate level of growth, had the most competitive infrastructure, had the highest skilled workers, and had the most appropriate policy environment to help enable competitiveness is just no longer true. And so having a real honest discussion about what do we need to do about those things, and not take for granted that it's our birthright that these things are all going to be here is really important. There are a lot of components of the traded sector supply chains that are very sensitive to some of those choices, and it's not just direct labor costs. If you go talk to a contract manufacturer about where they're going to locate something, All of those things come into play. And depending on the elements of what those specific economics at specific sectors, at specific parts of supply chain, more than half of that can move in the next decade. And it'd be nice if those move in our direction for good reasons, as opposed to they're moving outside because of our bad choices.
Great, thank you. So thank you all for coming, and please join me in thanking a great panel this morning.